Take your Bibles and turn with me tonight to Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. Very familiar portion of Scripture. And because of the amount of Scripture that I'm going to read tonight, I'm just allowing you to go ahead and remain seated. We're going to begin verse 1 because we need to kind of look at the whole picture here. I may jump over some of it. But begin verse 1, Daniel chapter 3. It said, Nebuchadnezzar, the king, made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits and the breadth thereof 6 cubits, and he set it up in the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. The Nebuchadnezzar the king sent to gather together the princes and governors and the captains, the judges, the treasurers and the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the province to come to the dedication of the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Then the princes and the governors and the captains and the judges and the treasurers, the counselors, the sheriffs, and all the rulers of the provinces were gathered together unto the dedication of the image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. And they stood before the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Then an herald cried aloud, "To you it is commanded, O people, nations, and languages," that takes in everybody there, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up. And whoso falleth not down and worship shall the same hour be cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And therefore at that time when all the people heard the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, and all the kinds of music, all the people, the nations, and the languages fell down and worshiped the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. Wherefore at that time certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the king Nebuchadnezzar, "O king, live forever. Thou, O king, hast made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music shall fall down and worship the golden image. Whoso falleth not down and worshipeth, that he should be cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar in his rage and fury commanded that to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up?" Notice that. Verse 14. He said, "The gods which I have set up, the images which I have set up," he said, you're not worshiping my images and my gods here. And that's important, what we're going to talk about tonight. "Now if ye be ready that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made, well, but if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands?" And boy, I tell you what, that's a big question right there, isn't it? You begin to think today, people are saying, who's the God that can take care of this world? Who's the God that can, who is your God that can take care of you? And who is the God that can deliver us from all the junk that's going on in this world? Well, there's a God in heaven that can do that, amen? And he's the one that we're to follow. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we're not careful to answer thee in this matter. Otherwise, we don't have to think about this. This is not up for debate. This is not something that we got to get over in a corner and take a vote on. It's not something that we've got to call home about. It's not something that we got to look up in a dictionary somewhere or that we've got to test the winds of which way the political scene is going. We're not careful about it. We can give you an answer right now. If it be so, our God whom we serve," notice it says whom we serve. Nebuchadnezzar's talking about the God that he serves. Now they're talking about the God that they serve, says, "is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not," otherwise if he chooses not to, "be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace 17 times more than it was wont to be heated. And he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats and hosen and their hats and their other garments and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's commandment was urgent and the furnace was exceeding hot, the flame of the fire slew those men that took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then Nebuchadnezzar, the king, was astonished and rose up in haste and spake and said unto his counselors, "Did not we cast three men bound into the midst of the fire?" And they answered and said unto the king, "True, O king." He answered, "Lo, I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God." Back in verse 17 and 18, I want you to look at that. It says, "If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." I'd like to preach a message I've titled, "Being a Christian in the World Today." Being a Christian in the world today. Let's pray. Father, we come to you. We ask, Lord, that you meet with us tonight. Lord, I pray that you give me clarity of thought. And Lord, help me to preach that which is pleasing unto you. Lord, I pray that you would forgive me of my sins where I failed and sinned against you, Lord, even this day. Make me a vessel meet for the master's use. Use me, Lord. May Jesus Christ be magnified. Lord, may we be of help to the people tonight. Lord, this is your people. This is your church. And Lord, I pray that not for my sake, but for your sake, Lord, that you do something great in hearts and lives tonight, Lord, and challenge and strengthen. And we'll give you the honor and glory, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's a day when being a Christian at work or at the store or with your extended family or wherever you might be is becoming harder and harder and harder. Taking a stand is becoming harder and harder for many. You have here in this chapter Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They're just trying to do their work as governors, leaders in the country. They're just out there trying to do what they're supposed to do for their work. And they was doing a good job at it. And basically, if you go back, you find that they were jealous of them because they had been promoted because of what Daniel had done. Daniel had made inroads with Nebuchadnezzar and told him of his dream and everything. And he set Daniel over the province himself. And then Daniel set these other three up in positions to lead, and they were jealous of them. And to be honest with you, you know, we talk about, you know, we live in a day and time. The big word is racist. Can I tell you that this is a picture of racism in many ways? Because they were Jews, and the Babylonians didn't like them. And so they wanted to do away with them. And one of the ways they found a way of doing this is because they didn't bow down to Nebuchadnezzar's image. Can I tell you something tonight? When you're at work, when you're at the grocery store, when you're someplace else and you're trying to live for God, trying to do what's right, trying to serve God, it may be at a family gathering, may be at a family reunion, it might be at a next door neighbor's house, it might be whatever it is, that there's going to be those who are going to try to cause you to stumble and to fall, who are looking down upon you because you are trying to live for the Lord Jesus Christ. Your life puts them under conviction. They know what's right. Okay, you say, "Well, preacher, how do you say they know they're right, what's right?" Because they're not saved. Because the God has written it upon the tables of their heart. Go back to Romans chapter 2. He has written it upon the tables of their hearts. And they know that there is a God and they know what is right. Can I tell you something tonight? Many times the meanest people that you're going to run into are Christians. That don't want to serve God. That want to be like the world. And they will try to get you shoved off into the fire. But you have these three Hebrews here that were trying to do what's right as governors in land, but they see them falling prey to the wicked, and even in their day, as Nebuchadnezzar tries to bolster his ego by getting everyone to worship an image that he set up. Well, this world's going to try to get you to bow too. I don't care how long you've been saved. I don't care how strong of a Christian you are. This world, in the day and time in which we're living right now, is going to try to get you to bow. And when I say bow, that means to lower your stand for God. That means to begin to accept the world and their ways. I've been amazed, you know, this Amendment 3 thing. I've been amazed how many people that claim to be Christians, they have come across with this idea that there is times when abortion is right. It's never right.
Amen.
It's never right. Because when we do that, we're taking away what God has allowed to create life. Is every circumstance exactly right and good? No. Well, you know, that child could be born with great difficulties. Everybody, is there a hymnal around you? Pick up a hymnal. 90%+ of the hymnals or the Bible or the songs in that hymnal that you're holding were written out of difficulties, adversities, death, persecutions, lives that were a mess. And a bunch of them was written by people who were blind. Fanny Crosby. And yet we think that because there's going to be some struggles in a life, that we should end the other life. And I'm not here to preach on Amendment 3, but what I am trying to get us to see is that the world will try to get you to bow to trying to give you reasons why you should bow to the way the world thinks. And that you should bow to the images that they set up. That you should bow to the things that are before you. The world is trying to get you and I as Christians to quit trying to live following the Bible. There in this world's going to try to get you to bow. In verse 5 there, in verse 6, it says, "And that at the time ye hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harpbuck, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up. And whoso falleth not down in worship shall the same hour be cast into the midst of the fire, the burning fiery furnace." And so they're going to say, okay, here's what you've got to do. You've got to bow to this. You've got to. This is what is socially accepted. If you don't, you know what we're going to do? We're going to call you a racist. We're going to call you a homophobic. We're going to call you all these things. We're going to label you. We're going to do away with you in any manner that we possibly can. Cancel you. That's the word I'm looking for. We're going to cancel you. Well, man, if I'm on their list, I want them to cancel me anyways. The fact is that that's what the world that we're living, they're trying to get you to bow. But here's the bigger picture. Let me give you the bigger picture before I go on from this spot. Who is it that's trying to get you to bow? Satan. Satan is trying to get you and me to lower the standard, to lower the worship, to lower who we're following, to give in to the world and be like the world and still yet call it Christianity, to ease up on what the book says, to ease up on what God tries to get us to do, and get us to bow. They're going to try to give you some good old mood music here. Notice what they did? Said, when you hear the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, fall down. This world will try to set the mood to get you to accept what you normally wouldn't accept. Preacher, that don't work with me. When I was a kid, homosexuality was not even spoken of in public. The Hollywood industry took it and began to make jokes about it and began to put them in shows and make them make people laugh at them because of that. Then they moved and changed the mood a little bit with their scenes and made them the ones that were being abused and beat down to get you to feel sorry for them. What does music do? Gets you to laugh, gets you to enjoy. You switch the song, gets you to cry. And then they took it in. And they took that person and they put them in a position to be the hero. What does music do? Good patriotic music makes you want to stand up and be the hero. And then they took that person and they become the ones that were abused by everybody else. You have what we call the tear-jerking songs. This world will try to set the mood to get you to accept. And today, what do we have? We have acceptance of a lifestyle that God has called an abomination. Now, I'm not preaching about this tonight. I'm just trying to give you an example of how Satan will try to get you to take you down the line and get you to let up here, get you to let up here, get you to let up here, and before long you have bowed to the whole thing. And so we're in this battle where the world's system and Satan will try to change your mood about things, try to make it look good, and everyone is doing it, make it appealing. Isn't it amazing how Satan will take and try to make things look appealing that will destroy your life? But he makes it look appealing. Then they're going to try to put the fear in you if you don't go along with their mood music, you might say. They're going to try to put the fear in you and say, if you don't bow to this world and its gods, you're going to lose your job. You're going to be fired. So is that a play on the words there? Yeah. You're going to be fired. You're going to get ridiculed. You're going to be the outcast. You're going to be labeled the fanatic, the homophobic, the cultic, old-fashioned believer, and so on goes the different things that they'll label you with. If the world can't get you to join them in bowing, they're going to push to try to get you pushed back into a dark corner if it's at all possible. That's what was happening with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Satan's plans haven't changed over the years. He still does the same thing. But Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10, verse 28, "And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." Can I tell you something? We better get it in our heads who we're going to stand before as our judge one day. Yeah. I am not going to stand before President Biden, Kamala Harris, and Tim Walz, or whatever his name is, when I die one day. I'm going to stand before God. I'm not going to stand before Hollywood and give an account why I didn't watch their filthy movies. I'm going to stand before God and give an account if I did watch their movies. I'm not going to stand before all the wicked song people and give an account to them why I didn't promote their music and sing their music in the church house. I'm going to stand before God and give an account of what we did sing in the church house. Why should I fear somebody that's going to be cast out one day into a lake of fire forever and ever? And yet today it seems as though that is who we fear, and that's who we bow to, that's who puts the pressure on us. And if we're not careful, we begin to drift to the world and become like the world and do what the world does. The Lord said, don't fear them. He said, you better get in your mind who you're to live for and who's going to be your judge. how you're supposed to live in this world. Jesus himself, as he was praying for the disciples, but if you go on down in chapter 17 there, John, he said, I pray not only for them, but also for, and he basically was saying for you and me. And he said, I pray not that you take them out of the world, but you keep them from the evil of the world, the wickedness, the gods of this world. He prayed for you and me because he knew that you and I were going to be pushed and shoved towards a fire if we didn't bow to the world's gods. That's why he prayed for us. And so we've got to be cautious what we do. First thing we got to do is we got to recognize what's going on around us. And all this stuff that's going on is they're trying to get us to bow to the things of the world. We need to take a lesson here from the three Hebrew boys here in the Bible. In verse 18 of Daniel 3, it says, "But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods," little g, "or worship the golden image which thou hast set up." They was emphatic about it. From Genesis to Revelation, we're taught not to bow to any other god. And there's many, and we're not to allow our lives to be caught up in the things of this world. You see, not all gods are made by hands. Nebuchadnezzar's image was made by hands. We have the god of money, material things and possessions. How about this one? Popularity, to be accepted. We live in a day and time when people are so engulfed in being accepted by everybody in the world. Say, how do you get that, preacher? How many times, it's amazing, they did a study, and I wish I had brought that information. How many times the average person looks on something that they've posted on social media, whether it be TikTok, Facebook, or any of the other social medias, to see how many likes they've got. Their whole life is wrapped around the likes that they get for something they said, a picture they took, a video they've made. And they go back constantly. As soon as they post it, boy, every little bit, they're going back and checking it 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 and checking it. Oh, I'm up to 40. I'm up to 80. I'm up to 150. I'm up to 1,000. I'm up to 3,000. And man, they're just going wild. And they're going back and checking this thing. Why? Because they want to be accepted. Can I tell you what? That can become your God. Of wanting everybody to accept you. But might I tell you tonight that if you're going to live for God, not everybody's going to accept you. And that's a good thing. It's really a good thing. Not only that, but our pride can become our God. Status. On goes the list of things. Many bow to in this life. We're not to bow to the gods, little g, of this world, nor are we to change our stand for the Lord Jesus Christ. We're needing to take a stand for God and not change that stand. We're not to bow to the gods. We're to stand. In Galatians 5:1, it says, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free." Let me read that part again. "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free." We've been freed from all those little gods, from all the junk of this world, through salvation through Jesus Christ. And he goes on and says, "And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage." These little gods put you in bondage. You're not free. He says, "Stand. Stand what? Stand fast in the liberty. Stand fast in Jesus Christ. That's what Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did. They stood fast. They didn't bend. They didn't bow. They didn't burn. They stood fast. They stood their ground. But with the stand that they took came the anger and the fire. Look at verse 19. Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat up the furnace 7 times more than it was wont to be heated. If you look at that where it says, and the form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Say, what does that mean, preacher? Before this time, he liked them. Before this happened, he liked them. They were leaders in his government. He liked them. They did a good job. He didn't have to worry about what they was doing. He liked them. If it had been somebody else, he wouldn't have given them a second chance. He said, just throw them in the fire furnace. That's what we said. But now he's given them a second chance because he liked them. But when they said, we're not going to do it, says his visage was changed toward them. He got mad. He got angry. And it was like this: you don't talk to me that way, and nobody else talks to me that way. I am the king. So you're going to burn. Can I tell you something? This world may like you to a point, but there'll come a day, if you take a stand, they won't like you. They may call you when grandma's sick and say, pray for grandma. They may call you when they want you to do their funeral. They may call you when they want to marry, do their weddings. They may call you when everything goes good for you and them together. But when you take a stand that is against what they are standing for, their visage is going to change against you. They're going to get mad. They're going to get angry. This can be family members. This can be co-workers. This can be whoever it is, a neighbor or whatever. If you're living for God and it begins to rub against them and bothers them and creates a friction burn in their life, that, hey, listen, they're going to get mad. The world's going to become angry and try to build a bigger fire to throw you in when you take a stand for the Lord and against their wicked ways. His visage was changed, and therefore he commanded that they should heat the furnace 17 times more than it was wont to be heated. As we read on there, we find that it was so hot that the soldiers, the mightiest men that they had, when they got close enough to throw them into the fire killed them. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego fell down headlong into that fiery furnace, but it didn't kill them. Notice you don't find the three Hebrew boys here saying, well, since you put it that way, Neb, let us reconsider our position on this. Or backing down even when they know that their life was on the line. They don't do it. Can I tell you what's happening in the world today in a lot of churches? We're embracing the world. Christians are embracing the world. Why? Because they don't want to upset the world. They're afraid of making somebody mad. Can I tell you? You got a choice. I've got a choice. I'm not going to try to make somebody mad, but if standing for the Lord makes them mad, that's just what's going to have to do, because I don't want to make God mad. Amen. And so that's where they were at. In verse 17, it says, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fire furnace. He said, well, no. And he'll deliver us out of thine hand, O king. Otherwise, you're not as big as our God. You think you are, but you're not. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou set up. Guess what? They weren't bluffing. We got too many Christians today that are bluffing. Yeah, bless God, I'm going to serve God. I'm going to live for God. Next thing you know, you don't even see them in church. We've got to have Christians who are going to stand, who are going to live for God. They were standing on their trust in the Almighty God. But with the stand came the fire. Now, this is important. I want you to get this. God can keep you from going into the fire. God can keep you from going through the fires of life. God can put the fire out. God can change your position so that you will not face the fires. Or he'll meet you in the fire and protect you from the fire. Or use the fire, and this one we don't really like to talk about, or use the fire to bring you into his presence in heaven. Because in every instance that I just mentioned, God is involved in your life concerning the fire that you're going to face. You don't have to face the fire of this world and the anger of this world alone. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they may have felt all alone, but they, in their minds, in their hearts, they knew, hey, listen, God's going to take care of this thing. And if he chooses not to preserve us from the fire, hey, listen, that's okay, because he's just going to take us into his presence. And that means he took care of the fire, didn't he? 1 Peter 3 says in verse 14, he says, but, and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye. And be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. You're going to face some difficult days when people get angry and want to push you into the fire. But believe me, God has a plan even when the enemy has a furnace. You ought to write that down. God has a plan when the enemy has a furnace. And he'll help you through the furnace. Well, you stop and think about it. He could have killed Nebuchadnezzar. Ended it. Those guys come to take a hold of him, to bind them. He could have killed them. He could have put the fire completely out in the furnace before they ever got there. He could have made the image crumble before there was ever the temptation. But God chose to allow them to be thrown into the fire. Why? So that they could meet the presence of God. So that God was real. So that their faith was increased. So that God could do something special in their life and in the lives of others around them. Their stand for the Lord was a powerful testimony to others around them. Many times we don't realize how powerful it is. See, the Lord wants to build us in the fire. When you are facing the troubles, when you're facing the fires, when you're facing the anger, when you're facing the difficulties, when you're facing all that's going on in this world, God wants to build you. He wants to strengthen you. He wants to make you a powerful witness for him. Verse 24 and 25 says, then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astonished and rose up in haste and spake and said unto his counselors, did not we cast three men bound in the midst of the fire? And they answered and said unto the king, true, O king. He answered and said, lo, I see four men loose walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. They had been bound, but they were loose in the midst of the fire. And get this concerning your fire that you're going to face in life at times. Sometimes it takes the fire to set us free. Sometimes it takes the fire to set us free from self, from unbelief, from things in our lives that shouldn't be there, so that we can walk with God. They walked around in the midst of the fire. They were bound before they went into the fire, but the fire set them free. Can I tell you something? Some of the freest places that you will ever be is when you trust God in the middle of the fire. Why? Because it helps get rid of the other stuff. 1 Peter 5, verse 10 says, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while. Notice what he says here, make you perfect, otherwise mature, establish, strengthen, settle you. The fire will strengthen you. It will settle you. It will mature you. Their stand for the Lord was a powerful testimony to others. Look at verse 26. Then Nebuchadnezzar came near and to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake. Said, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, you servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth of the midst of the fire. Now, you find something here that the one that made the image is looking at the Most High God. There's someone greater than him. There's someone greater than his image. This world, when they see you and I go through the fire and see us stand and trust the Lord Jesus Christ, it's a testimony. I have a lot of people at times will ask me, and I know Brother Auger has had over the years too, when people are going through absolute difficult times, they've been trying to live for God, trying to do what's right, but they go through absolutely difficult times. Maybe health. I think of Sean, I think of Diane Fahler that are suffering with the pain. I think of Donna Raymer. And many times people have asked me why. Why? We don't have the answer. But many times the thought that comes to my mind is this. The pain and the struggle may not be for you, but may be for somebody else. To see how you handle the fire. It's not what we want. And we sure would wish it would be something easier. Many times we don't understand why. But there's been times when I've talked to people after people have been through those difficulties and maybe even passed away, how that God has used that to reach them for Jesus Christ. As they seen him go through the fires. We find there it says, and then Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants that trusted in him and have changed the king's word and yielded their bodies, allowed God to use this, that they might not serve nor worship any god, little g, except their own God. Therefore, he's made a change here. He says, therefore, I make a decree that every people, nation, tongue would speak anything amiss against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be cut in pieces, and their houses shall be made a dunghill, because there is no other God that can deliver after this sort. What they went through made an impact. The fire that you go through, if you'll trust God, will make an impact. This world's watching. It'll not only make a difference in our lives as we live and stand firm for the Lord Jesus Christ, even in the midst of the fire, but it will have a great impact on those around us. So we need to take a stand for the Lord in this wicked day and not fear what man can do unto us, but live a life that brings honor and glory to the Lord, even in the fire. Maybe at work, it may be at home, it may be at the neighbor's house, it may be with family. But we got to stand for right, stand for the Lord Jesus Christ, that we might have an impact on this world. This easy believism, this easy Christianity is not making an impact. They need to see Christians that are real. Let's bow. Father, we thank you, we love you. We need to be that Christian, Christ-like, in this day, and live for you and serve you, magnify you, even in the fire. Lord, as we look at a world becoming more wicked and more wicked, they're going to be trying to push us closer to the fire. They're going to try to change us and appeal to us. But help us to stand firm with the Word of God. Help us to stand firm with the things of God. And live a life that glorifies God. Have your will and way, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.